Hello, I'm Jim Arraj, and I'd like to welcome you on behalf of the core group to this workshop on Zen awakening and Christian contemplation from the point of view of practice in both traditions. As the title indicates, and as you will find out from the panel, most of the people on the panel are dual practitioners. Almost everyone is a dual practitioner. And what we'd like to do is examine the kinds of questions that arise from carrying out a dual practice. So even though they may at times seem theoretical, we're going to be trying to come from the point of view of practice to examine those issues that are becoming more and more to the forefront as more and more people take up a dual practice. Today, each of the core members is going to give a short introduction about their own life from the point of view, touching on the point of view of dual practice and the kind of questions they see arising from it.
I am asked to first introduce myself and then also share some elements of my journey. But first of all, I would like to just express a hesitation about the term dual practitioner. I would like to understand my own practice or my own life not so much as a dual practice or dual life, but single practice that cuts across two traditions, the Buddhist and the Christian. Yeah. In my mid-teens, I somehow was faced with some fundamental questions about life and death, as we all are faced at some point of our lives. And so that led me to a search for it that somehow brought me to the novitiate of the Society of Jesus in the Philippines. And so there, I was given the privilege of being able to practice with within the tradition that was offered by St. Ignatius of Loyola, the spiritual exercises of St. Ignatius. And I went through that in the normal Jesuit formation process. And that, for me, was a very key or crucial turning point in my own life. So in my mid to late teens, I received an initial jolt, of course, which was a confirming experience of the many things I had been receiving since childhood. And in 1970, to make a long story short, I was sent as a missionary to Japan. And there I began my training in language and culture in Japan to be able to live and work there as a missionary. And it was in a place called Kamakura where I was initially assigned. And there I had the great fortune of having Father Thomas Hand, who is with us today, as my spiritual director. And Father Hand at that time was already receiving direction in Zen from Yamada Koun Roshi. And so he also encouraged me to join the Zen group as he was already doing so. And there, I found another turning point in my own life journey. What happened was basically that I was just led through the basic steps in Zazen, posture, breathing, and silencing the mind to a point of stillness. And from there, given the classic Mu Koan. And somehow or other, I must have been given a good tailwind after some weeks of trying it out and so on, and with a few hints from Yamada Roshi. So, after an afternoon session one Sunday, I came back home just trying to relax, beginning to look for a beer and so on. But as I was just sitting in my chair, something just suddenly dawned on me. Something that cracked that koan mu. And it came in an unexpected way, and somehow I knew, and I What did I know, if you ask me? Well, the only way I could answer in the image that came to me at that point was, I knew why the Buddha was smiling with that half smile, that there was something there. And so I knew what was behind that smile. And so somehow, well, it may sound like an exaggeration, but for me, the heavens and the earth opened, and I also burst out laughing, and I knocked at Tom Han's door and said, I got it. So, and I could not help from just laughing, and also I remember tears also streaming from my eyes. I've got to see Yamada Roshi. So from there, I telephoned Yamada Roshi, and so he was gracious enough to welcome me in Doksan that evening and gave me the usual check-in questions. Now, he said, well, there's something here, but let's ripen it a bit. So, but I still felt that I had to tell him something. He did not exhaust what I wanted to express to him. So I asked, can I see you again tomorrow? And so he gladly acceded. And when I saw him the next day and was given a few more questions, he said, yes, this is what we call the so-called Kensho experience in Zen. So from now on, your practice will be from a different angle, no longer trying to knock on a door, but now trying to open different kinds of doors to the same room. And you'll find out that there are no doors at all anyway. But the main thing is, well, I would like to express this in my own words now. It's like having gotten hold of a master key, and now you're within, and now you can easily go in and out and open those imaginary doors with your master key. And so each koan from here on will be like a door that you will be asked to open with that master key that you have now in your possession, which you can swallow if you wish. Anyway, and that was the point, to really swallow that master key so that you are the master key. And so after 16 or 17 years, that was in 1988 when Yamada Roshi gave me the permission to teach Zen to others in that way. So during that time, I found myself having to struggle with some basic things I held precious from my own background. Namely, as I said, I came to Japan as a missionary of the Christian gospel, and I realized that I had to rework my way at understanding what that Christian gospel was all about. Again, in my own struggle, what I was faced with was the challenge that Yamada Roshi himself placed upon those Christians whom he had admitted as disciples in practice. He said, well, Zen is something that does not rely on words or letters, as everyone knows is one of the cardinal principles of Zen. But it has to be expressed in words or letters, and so we have volumes of written material on Zen. But yet, not relying on words or letters, now, as you Christians deepen and purify your own experience in Zen, somehow, he said, I would like to invite you to attempt to express what you are experiencing in ways that will be able to resonate with those coming from your tradition. But before being able to express it for others, I had to be able to clarify it for myself, and so that was the struggle I had to undergo for several years. And I'm still in that process, if I may confess. And the point there is that I have simply discovered a new way of reading scripture in a way that does not just invite theological concepts, but a very, very direct way whereby the words of scripture address us here and now. And so just to give an example, the words of consecration in the Christian Eucharist, this is my body, a very powerful, primal word. And this word is not something that, well, of course, it can call for a lot of theological speculation, but rather than that, it invites us to a direct experience in the here and now of something that cuts through all our concepts. And so for me, this is what I would like to continue deepening in, namely an awareness and appreciation of that mystery which is offered to us in our Christian scriptures, and to be able to try to express this in a way that would also invite others to experience and not theological concepts and so on. So the main thing is that, well, Zen has opened up for me a dimension that It's not really different from what I had known, but yet gave a way of cracking that world in a very, very direct mode of simply taking a posture that is conducive to breathing and silencing. And with that mode of silencing, which is basically a disposing of our whole being to be able to listen to that mystery, now that has enabled me to listen a bit more from the very words that I was familiar with in Christian scripture. And so that is what my Zen journey has led me to.
I'm a Chinese, born and living in Taiwan, a Catholic nun in Taiwan. I was born and grew up in a Confucianist, Taoist, and Buddhist cultural milieu with no specific religious preference. However, in my early childhood, I was very much drawn to religious and spiritual values because of not understanding Buddhist teaching or even Taoist religious practices. I was kind of drawn to Christian values, very much drawn to Christian values. Such as the Beatitudes. What does it mean by blessed are the poor or blessed are the pure of heart? However, with no understanding, but I'm in love with it. Also, I was so curious looking at the cross. I was so curious about Jesus of Nazareth. And I questioned, you know, why he died such an unhuman death, and he draws so many people to him, and why so many missionaries that left their hometown and come to Taiwan. I asked this question, you know, I wanted to know really who he is and what he is. In his life story, I found he is a man, or he was a man of no self, selfless. He lived, to me, he lived a selfless life. And especially his death, to me, is so solemn. In Chinese, we say there are two kinds of death. One is as light as feather. Another kind is as heavy, as solemn as the mountain, a Thai mountain in Shandong province, which is one of the five mountains in China. So to me, I think his death is a very heavy and very solemn as the Mount Thai. After my high school, before my first year of high school, I went to a convent and asked for baptism. So after high school, again, I went to the convent, knocked at the door that I want to be a religious. So from there on, I entered an international religious community, and I got a religious training and formation. However, being in the convent, we have so many spiritual practices, saying the office, daily mass, station of the cross, and rosario, and et cetera, et cetera. And also, every morning, I listen to sermons and harmony and spiritual readings. In my religious formation, especially first 3 years in Taiwan, I found something was missing in our Christian, at least in my understanding of Christian teaching and Christian tradition. I found so many sermons and so many doctrinal teaching were simply non-convincing. However, in religious life, I enjoyed very much the practice of silence. From this practice of silence, I learned just doing. And also I enjoy the liturgy, especially Gregorian Mass and chanting office in the Latin. And those 2 hours, I felt I'm in heaven and chanting with the angels and all the saints throughout the ages. And that's, and now I understood why I enjoy these two practices. Now, only now, after I encounter Zen and after I encounter my own tradition, because I did not understand Latin. Yamada Roshi said, the words with meaning are dead. Words without meaning are alive. So it was in my undergraduate year that I was so fortunate to discover Tehati Shadan. And it was Tehati Shadan who led me back to my own tradition. Then I discovered, even before I, first I really began my turn by reading Tao Te Ching seriously as a meditation every morning from 7 to 7:50 where I was proctoring exam to the student. I read my Tao Te Ching, and that's really changed my consciousness. I only can, oftentimes I only can could read one or two sentences, and then I had to stop. I found our theology inconsistent and contradictory all over the place. And then when we have contradictory, then we say, this is a mystery. Then I say, no, it's not a mystery. It's not a mystery. You know why? Then I discover, being a Chinese and in a Taoist tradition, I discover our theology, our theory about God, why it is inconsistent, because it is not grounded in cosmology. And our spirituality, spiritual teaching, something is lacking, it's lifeless. You know, we're telling people you have to love God, you have to love people. Okay, then I ask how. I want to, but I don't know how to love. Can you tell me, can you give me a prescription, how to love God? I need this prescription. But you know, nobody tell me how to love God, and nobody tell me how to love the neighbor, and I don't know how. This is my problem. So I think our spiritual teaching, there's a lack of psychological foundation. It's not Chinese, really it's not Chinese. So I felt very much vocabulary, Christian vocabulary in different culture needs badly inculturation. And because in each culture does have sufficient vocabulary to be used. Okay, from Taoist tradition, I went into enter Zen world. It was kind of by myself by reading the Zen books in Chinese. Again, the same thing happened as it happened when I heard the Christian scripture. I read Zen books, Zen koan in Chinese. Then I was so happy. And at the same time, I was so frustrated. And I remember I often read the books late at night, and I had a book in my arms running around trying to find people and to share and to ask. But I didn't really understand, but I was very happy. So from Zen practice, I find out, first of all, I find in Zen, I find it is Chinese. Second, it's simple, practical, and intuitive. And after my encounter with Buddhism, with Zen, and with Taoist philosophy, I came, scripture became alive to me, and I can read scripture from not through my mind, but it just happened when I read the scripture, I know what is it and what happened. For instance, like the baptism of Jesus at Jordan River, to me, that is the moment that Jesus existentially find his ID card. It's not, you know, a voice or something happened, and also I can understand better the myth, creation myth in Old Testament, and I appreciate it very much. And through this integration, more and more, I appreciate and Christian treasure in treasure in Christian tradition. Okay, thank you.
I graduated from Catholic high schools, graduated from Bellarmine College Prep in San Jose, entered the Society of Jesus in 1938. I went through all the Jesuit training in the old style, full 13 years until ordination. And then at the end of my Jesuit training, at the end of tertianship in 1953, I went to Japan. I'd like to say that the first life-giving little experiences that I had in Japan came from Catholic sources. And I was reading this book, Something About Grace, of Karl Rahner, and he said, this sounds so simple and obvious, but he said, grace is not just a theological thing, it should be your experience. Now that doesn't sound like much, maybe, but for me that was a big experience, that I was supposed to experience grace. Those, from the first moment I arrived in Japan, I felt at home. I couldn't explain it, I felt at home. And the Japanese consciousness, which is manifested everywhere, in everything that happens there, fascinated me. When I was living in Tokyo briefly before going down to take up residence in the Kamakura Language School, I read the book in English manuscript of Father Hugo LaSalle's little book, Zen, The Way of Enlightenment. I had been interested in Zen just from afar. Something was drawing me. From the first time that I saw a little boy, somebody mentioned Zen when we were on a picnic when I was down in Hiroshima with the kids, and one little boy, as soon as somebody said Zen, he went into the lotus position and sat there, just straight like an arrow. And something clicked, and I could still remember seeing this little boy sitting in the lotus position saying Zen, but I didn't know what Zen was. I didn't know what anything about it. In April, I tried to sit. I used, as I say, the book of Father LaSalle, but it didn't work at all, and I wasn't getting anywhere. So finally, in spring, in April of 1967, I walked down the hill from our language school down to an old, somewhat dilapidated Zen temple, Jomyoji, where the Sambo Kyodan Zen group was meeting at that time. And at that time, it was a period of transition in which Yamada Roshi, who wasn't even called Roshi at that time, just Yamada Sensei, was gradually taking over from the main Roshi, Yasutani Hakuun Roshi. And so it was at that temple that I made my formal that Yamada Roshi, Yamada Sensei, accepted me formally as his Zen disciple in the classical Shoken ceremony. Probably, I was the first of the long line of, you can call them professional, religious, clerical Catholics that entered the Sambo Kyodan. As I say, I didn't know why I was there. I can remember during the Shoken ceremony when Yamada Roshi asked me, what is your kokorozashi? What is your aspiration, your intention for doing Zen? And I didn't really know. So I said something about togo, which means integration. And he didn't know what I was talking about, and I didn't. And then he went ahead and told me that there's two kinds of Zen. There's Buddhist Zen with all the Buddhist trappings and with the statues and all, everything else like that. And then there's just simply Zen. And he says, you do Zen and you become a better Christian. And that was true. And that was his policy, which he maintained wonderfully till the end of his life. In sittings, I started with breathing, then I went to Mu, And it took me a long, long time to get through Mu. I was like a wooden log, or rather, I was all stuck here, stuck up in the head. But finally, I did get through Mu. Kensho was approved, and so I continued. I started in the koan practice, but then after about 7 years from the beginning, in about my seventh year of Zen practice, circumstances led to me that I had to suspend the practice, but I've never really gone out of the Sambo Kyodan, and I've been practicing Zen ever since on my own. The deepest problems were those that were in connection with my whole mindset. First of all, in Zen, there is no personal God. Now, for a Christian, that's an immediate stumbling block. It's a tremendous thing if you really think of it. Thank you. There was no personal God. However, all of these problems that arose became a source of later profound changes in my mindset and in my life changes. For example, the profound personal God, which in a sense didn't disturb me, but was down deep. I wondered, what on earth is going on here when you can have a obviously highly developed, superb spiritual training going on with no knowledge of no personal God? Well, the answer to that began one day when I was standing on the roof of the language school, looking out in the west to a not particularly beautiful cloud bank, and suddenly something just clicked, switched, or turned inside of me. And all I could say, and I kept saying it all day to myself, and I've been saying it ever since, God is different. God is different. The second thing that was a deep problem was the kind of attention that was called forth by the Zen practice. I can still remember old Yastani Roshi thundering that you must become a hakushi, which means a blank sheet of paper. And then he would say, you must give up all judgment. And you have to give up judgment of pleasant or unpleasant. That's a judgment of feeling. You have to give up judgment of beautiful and ugly. And that's a aesthetical judgment. You have to give up true and false. And this was very powerful because this is an intellectual judgment. He said you have to give up moral judgment, right and wrong. Oh, and that's even more threatening for a Catholic, a Christian. And finally, and this was the big one, he says, you have to give up the judgment of good and bad, good and evil. And I didn't understand, couldn't follow him. However, sometime later, again, this bore fruit in a total change in my consciousness. I woke up very early in the morning, and I lay there in a kind of a semi-awake stage, which is an excellent state, because the poor old logical, busy mind can't get going at that time. And so that was when I suddenly realized powerfully, there is a world beyond good and evil. And it changed my whole consciousness, and so that evil is not a problem for me, down deep. Then the last one that I'll take up briefly is, where is Jesus Christ in this? I can still remember sitting there saying moo, moo, moo all day long, and saying, where on earth is Jesus Christ in this? Because for a Christian, we are to learn of Christ. We are to follow Christ. Well, was following Mu following Christ? And it was a huge, really, that was perhaps the biggest problem. Here I am, a Jesuit dedicated to Christ Jesus and all this, Catholic and all that. This led actually to a series of insights, and they continue over the years. Zen was always looking for the self. And you start with a small letter self and find the big letter self. Where in Christianity, you try to get rid of yourself. We talk about not only self-denial, but self-hatred, right in the Imitation of Christ. And so you look at Christ, you find yourself in Christ, and it's a valid path. But what I did come to find was the importance of the first personal pronoun of Jesus Christ in the scriptures. That is the most important word in all the scriptures in my mind. I won't try to go into that more. I'll leave it open for questions. But if you really go into what Christ Jesus means by me, I, my body, if you accent that and get into it, you will find yourself, you will find all reality.
I'm Susan Postal. Ji-on is my Dharma name. I'm a Zen priest, a student of the late Maureen Stewart, who was from this area. And my Zen training is completely homegrown. I'm a product of American Zen, which in some ways, although I feel very poorly trained and kind of bumbling along, the Dharma has taken root here in this country, because my teachers were American, their teachers were Japanese. Now, my own religious background, again, very different. I had rebellious parents. They left Christianity after they were confirmed, both of them as Lutherans in Europe, and they found this Lutheran, my father was from Alsace, my mother from Northern Germany. They met in this country and were both rebels. My father went to Science of Mind lectures. My mother followed Krishnamurti around. I said I wanted to go to church like my friends. They said, we're not going. You find your own way. My friends went to church, the neighborhood Presbyterian church. So I went to church. And like Sister Agnes said, I fell in love somewhere. I was so, and when about the age of 12, I guess that's when this happens, of falling in love with Jesus somehow. And I stood up and accepted Jesus and did sort of various things and tried to get my parents to go. They grudgingly came one Easter, because I said, it's Easter, you know, and they came once. And then when I was about 14 or 15, taking religious ed programs in the youth group, of which I was very active, they started talking about the boxes, that if you didn't believe in here, you weren't saved. That kind of boxes began to be drawn, very much like what Rita spoke about, without the trauma side. I didn't feel wounded like she did. But I just didn't buy it. And I remember saying, if God pervades everywhere and in all things, why is he outside a box? And what are these lines? And then I went to college, and a friend of mine took me to hear this fellow, Alan Watts, give a lecture. And I was not even 18. It was my freshman year, and it was 1958, I think, early 58. I was at Stanford, your environs. And it was literally a light bulb experience. It was like, that's it. That's it. And I didn't know what it was, but I was completely convinced that this made sense, this Zen. And I remember going back to my dorm and trying to sit Zazen, but I didn't know what I was doing. So I heard this lecture of Alan Watts, and I read D.T. Suzuki, because that's all I knew about. I didn't know Shunryo Suzuki was in San Francisco practicing. I didn't know. How did you know? All I knew was books. So I wrote papers on Zen and existentialism and Zen and this, and my professor said I was crazy. And the Western mind can't understand this stuff. So about 1969, early 1970, I took first vows, bodhisattva vows, in the Tibetan tradition. And Madame de Salzman had kind of warned me. She said, you're going to have a lot of trouble with Tibetan religion, and I did. It just somehow wasn't quite congenial for me. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it. It just didn't fit this person very well. But I learned a tremendous amount. On the one side, I had a good Dharma foundation of understanding the teachings of Buddhism, because the Tibetan tradition starts with knowledge about the way reality works, as Vicky presented yesterday. It's very thoroughgoing. On the other side, it was demanded that I do practices that I didn't want to do. And I had to do 100,000 of all these different mantra, and I thought that was bizarre and crazy and stupid. I mean, really, that wrong, strong. And so somewhere I was given the instruction that it didn't matter whether I liked it or didn't like it, or whether I had faith in it or didn't have faith in it, but if I would do these things, they would do their work. It did turn out that somewhere I wasn't at home in the Tibetan tradition, and I yearned for this Zen that had been the original kind of, that's it. And so in 1980, I became a Zen student in a formal way. But as a layperson, at that time, I was then a single mother raising two kids and working full time and sitting a lot. I'm feeling tremendous gratitude for this kind of no-nonsense approach in Zen, which doesn't let us cling to anything and certainly not embroider our little spiritual hat. You know, now I do Zen, and we decorate ourselves. And there's none of that if we're really in a kind of letting go practice. I came to an impasse with my teacher at one point, and I don't want to share the whole impasse because it's complicated, and of course he was right in many ways. But we missed each other somehow, and I entered a very dark space where I felt somehow as though the very core of who I am in this life, this little baby budding bodhisattva, was not being understood and supported. And I actually wanted to die. I thought, if this isn't good enough, then what's it all about? And I was in a place where I think if my son hadn't been living with me, I don't think I'd be here. It was that bad. I was starting to injure myself physically, and I was finished. I had decided I was not a good Zen student. I walked into a church and started to pray. I don't know why I went to that church. It was close by. It was an Episcopal church. I'd heard a concert there, and I liked the architecture and the music. They had evening prayer. Every evening. So I didn't like to go to church on Sundays. It didn't fit for so many years, but I'd go every evening, and they read the Psalms, and we prayed, and there was about five or six people that met down in the basement of the church. And I didn't say anything. I just wept. And I said, do you mind if a Zen student prays here? And he said, fine. So I went and I wept. And I did this every day of the week, because it was every day. And I'd go to work and come home and cry, and then go home and have dinner with my son. And somewhere, I just needed to put myself in a place where I could give up, and that would be supported. And I didn't, somewhere what I began to see was that I was giving up, but that didn't mean I had to die physically. I didn't have to kill myself. That I was literally giving up. Susan just couldn't do it anymore. I couldn't go on. But that for whatever moved my feet into a place where that surrender could then be the beginning of a new life. I didn't know all that. I mean, looking back, I just knew I had to be there because I didn't know there was nothing else to do. So after about 2 months of this daily weeping in the basement of this church with these people who thought they didn't know what to think anyway. They thought. One night, everybody got up and I didn't get out of my chair. I couldn't move. And I'm trying to remember what I felt. I remember feeling that I couldn't get up. There was nobody to get up. And the priest there, whose name was Father Godley, it's really wonderful. he said, "Oh, you want to talk?" I said, "I don't know." And he said, "Come in my study," which was the next room of this basement chapel. So we walked into his study, and he said, "I see a terrible wounding," because I'd never told him anything what I was going through, just that, "May I come?" And I said, "Yes." He said, "Do you want to talk about it?" I said, "No." He said, "Do you want to pray for healing?" I said, "Okay." I mean, I was like wood. I couldn't. I didn't want to walk. I just, no functioning. Now my time is up?
No.
Oh, that's in case I cry? That's all right. Got one right here. Thank you. It's a great group. Anyway, thank you. So he started chatting with me, you know, like just to make me feel better. And he was telling me how he was going to do this and this, and he was going to baptize somebody this weekend, a little baby. Nah, nah. And all of a sudden, it came out from my stomach. I said, "Will you baptize me?" I'd never been baptized because my parents were off listening to Krishnamurti and Signs of Mind. And he said, "Now?" And I said, "I don't know." I mean, that's all I kept saying was, "I don't know." He said, "Well, let's pray." So he held out his hands, and I put my hands on his, and he said, "It's okay now." And this is like not following any of his rules at all. And he said, "Let's go into the chapel," which was where we'd left. And we left all the candles burning. He said, "Funny we left all the candles. We must have known we're coming back." And he took out a little tin basin, a little cup. There was nobody there. And he opened this book and he said, "Are you comfortable with these words?" I said, "I can translate pretty well," because it wasn't my language. And he proceeded with the baptism. I don't know what happened, because as I said, I was in a funny place. But he tells me I started to smile and giggle. And he'd never seen me smile. What I knew was that my heart was set on fire, as though this huge match just touched this fuel that had always been there and went. And all the pain was just completely healed. There wasn't even a residue of with the problem with my teacher, anything, which was completely healed. And I had this new life in my heart that I can only describe as sitting with Christ or being with Christ. It was just burning. And I thought, "Oh my God, what's going on?" And I thought I would feel some blessing from above, and I didn't know I was going to feel burning from within. And I was like really like rattled. I didn't say anything to Father Godley. He was watching. And I said, "I have to go home now." And I went home, and I drove home, and I thought, "Oh, my God." And I walked in the house, and Jonathan, my dear poor son, went through all so much stuff. He says, "Where have you been?" I said, "Well, I was just baptized." He said, "You what?" So anyway, I don't want to talk too long, but the next day I went to the Zendo, which is my custom, and I sat down and I said, "What do I do?" And it was as though I could talk to my heart, which was very odd. And I got this very strong, almost word, "Sit here with Christ." That's it. Sit. Keep sitting. Don't move from this cushion. I don't feel two things. And I don't feel I have dual practice. I'm glad Jim used that, because I disagree with that phrase, and it gives us all something to talk about. But what I do feel is like, I'm going to use a funny word because I don't know another one, like two lineages or two intravenous tubes, you know? It's like something has entered through the Buddha Dharma, and it's my life, and it flows in my veins. And we call this lineage, whether it's a particular line through a particular teacher or the Dharma. And so that flows, and it's my bones. But something also happened in that little church, and that also flows. And they all stir together. And I don't find in my heart, in my practice, moment after moment, I can't find a different color fluid from each intravenous. You know, it's of one color and one flavor, and yet they entered differently. And yet they had a different flavor in some way, but not in their functioning. I guess that's what I feel.
The last few weeks of August of 1945, just after World War II,
I was 6 years old. We bought an old home that had belonged to missionaries to Japan and Korea. And in the room that was to be my bedroom was the missionary hunkering down with several boxes of letters. I guess he had made a last-minute effort to separate those he would keep and those he would throw away. And I looked at the letters that he had, and not one of them was in English, and not one of them was in the Roman alphabet. And for a child just about to enter school who knew the alphabet and a few words like cat and dog, it might be an archaic expression nowadays, but it blew my mind. And something just imprinted itself on my heart from the age of six, and I guess it is still with me. I went to school in the South because my father insisted upon a university education, even if it was a ballet major, and there were only three at the time. So I chose one in Texas, and going to school in Texas was a very big change for someone who was from Pennsylvania. It was also the year that James Meredith entered University of Alabama or University of Mississippi, and it was not easy to make friends in Texas that year, and so I read a lot of books. And among the books, I found a book with a short, terse title, Zen, and that was my start. And I read Zen books from the age of 17 on to the age of 34, any and every book that I could get my hands on. I was able to dance professionally. The competition is very, very keen. And at the point where I could have made it or not made it, I got very sick, and I knew that I would be second string after having recovered from pneumonia. And I entered a marriage that seemed to be there in place. And we were sent to Japan for business for 3 years. Everything paid for by the company. And so busy, I never got in touch with the Japan that I had really wished to get in touch with. And when we came back to America, we realized that the only thing we had in common was this interest in Japan. But it wasn't possible for his work to have him back there again. And so we went our own separate ways. And I returned to Japan. And instead of having company housing, had a 4.5 mat room, which is the size of 4.5 single beds. From 17 to 34, only books. Well, when I hit Izafu, I hit home base, and I knew where I was, and I knew where I belonged. And I passed out the first day because I sat with such determination. I just conked out. I studied as a lay practitioner for 3.5 years with Omori Roshi in a very, very severe setting. He was kind, but those around me made it clear in no uncertain terms where my seat was for Zazen, where my seat was for tea, where my place was for calligraphy. And I needed to do Zazen badly enough that those conditions were just fine for me. But when it came to talk of ordination, it was not possible. And then he had a stroke shortly after, and there was no way that I could continue in that lineage. I decided to do the pilgrimage around the island of Shikoku, the 88 temples, which takes about 6 weeks to walk. And I just said the Heart Sutra at each temple, going for heart and body. I found a temple between 82 and 83, a little tiny sign that said, a Zen dojo that-a-way. All of these other temples were Shingonsek temples on high mountains. And I went to check it out, and what did I find but five soy sauce vats turned upside down with doors and windows cut in them and makeshift tin roofing on it and sukiyaki pot on the top point so that the rain wouldn't go in. And there was a bus there. When I looked in the bus, there were no seats. There was a beautiful yellow carpet, and in the overhead racks were the zafu, and in the back, lovely Bodhidharma. And it was as though scales fell from my eyes. I thought, of course, you don't need an expensive temple or an ancient temple. You just need to be the real thing. You need to be a real teacher. And I said, may I practice here? It looks lovely. It looks like I wouldn't have asthma trouble here. And he said, no. I said, I beg your pardon. He said, if you don't have full ordination, you cannot train here. And then it just came up to my throat, and I said, but that's what I have been hoping for. But I began to chicken. I don't know if I could do that. That means no money. That means having my head shaved. What if something goes wrong in Japan? It's not my country. I'm far away. It took me 6 months to decide, go back to my family in America, discuss it with my family, and come back and finally do it. To enter the world of that kind of training is 180 degrees different from anything you can ever imagine. Your whole evaluation is turned upside down. And our practice in Soto sect is to live that every second, not just with the teacher. Everyone and everything and every moment is our teacher. And the rougher it is, the bigger and better the teacher, the bigger and better the teaching opportunity. Coming from central Pennsylvania, I didn't know what it was to be a minority, but I did in Japan. I didn't when I was a guest with my hair and my Western clothes, but I did when I left my hair behind and became a monk, a female monk with the others. And found that how pretty or how nice or how clean I was had nothing whatsoever to do. There was no way I could get people to like me, no way at all, if they were not able to relate to my being of a different race. After the 1 year had been completed with him, and he sent me to the women's monastery. The second year there, we had to have our dormitory torn down because it was about to be, condemned. Water patterns in the walls and snakes taking shortcuts across the hallway. And so we lived like rodents in nooks and crannies of other buildings until the new building was put up, and many of us got very sick with tuberculosis and pneumonia. And in my case, it was only malnutrition. This was perhaps the most important lesson that I got, because from my former dancing days, I was strong. I was playing Superwoman, and I had finally the opportunity to see what it is to be sick, what it is to be old, what it is to be frail. And the only way you know that is to be there. Sister Agnes asked yesterday, what is the prescription to love people? And I thought about that last night. And I think the only answer I can say right now is live, get sick, get hurt, and get old. And maybe in those personal experiences, maybe, if you are blessed with that karma, you will experience what others experience, and then you cannot help but love them, because there is no difference between the love of self and other. I close with a comment by my Dogen, by my Rinzai brother, who said, Dai-en, now you are going back to the United States. When you plant a tree, when you transplant a tree, it's good to cut back the leaves and the branches so that it can travel easily, but always make sure that you have a lot of rich earth at its roots so that you carry the roots and the earth around it to give the tree good nourishment. And he said, that rich nourishment around the roots are your tradition. But the leaves and the branches are the extraneous parts of your robes and how you look. So take good care of your roots, but look well to how much you can cut back on the leaves and the branches. So that is the stage that I'm in now. These are all I have. I don't have civvies, and I don't feel justified to spend alms money on Western clothes. But should these wear out, then probably that's what I will go into.
When I tell you that I came from a pious Catholic family and was educated by nuns and then went to a Jesuit high school, you will not be surprised to hear that I entered the Jesuits. And then a few years later, I volunteered to go to Japan to convert the Japanese to Roman Catholicism. God is very patient. I was in Japan then, and I came to ordination just at the time of the Second Vatican Council, which was a great sea change in the life of the church. It was the end of the post-Reformation period in Catholicism and the end of a whole Catholic culture, which was the only culture that I knew. Now, a sea change should not frighten a sailor, but because of my limitations, because of who I was and where I was, this end of the only Catholic culture that I knew was very traumatic. And from that fire, I learned a few lessons which I would like to pass on to you, even though, of course, they are quite clear to you. The first is never to confuse God with the way God is manifested in a particular culture. Another lesson is that faith demands the destruction of what faith built. God asks us to renounce not just the worst that is in us, but the best that is in us. I also learned that we do not know God. Again, we do not know God's will. Or again, we do not know God's providence. We must be aware of all religious teachers who speak glibly about these things. This was put most beautifully and unforgettably for me by St. Basil in the 4th century, when he said, "Anyone who says he knows God is perverted." Not simply wrong-headed, but perverted. Now, you say, well, this is just apophatic theology. Surely you knew these things. There's nothing new here, my heavens. But there's a difference between knowing things and having them burned into your soul. So at this time, I began to sit because I knew something of Japan. I was living there. People were sitting, and I tried to reduce prayer to its simplest form. I was finished with God talk. I didn't know what else to do, so I just tried to sit quietly. Now, at this time, I was very lucky. I was helped by my fellow Jesuits in Japan, Father William Johnston, who had done so much theological work with the Buddhists. The Zen master, Father Kadowaki, and the Zen teacher, Father LaSalle, were all there. How lucky could I be? And they sent me to Yamada Roshi in Kamakura. I think psychologically what he was to me was a father figure. He was wise and broad and a man completely without anger, but sure of himself and what he wanted to teach. There was nothing in him of that narrow, nitpicking, you know, negative religious figure. In a word, I loved him. The point of Zen training is to grasp the teaching of the Buddha and to live it out. It is not to be a Buddhist. That is another world again. Now, you can be a Buddhist if that is your thing, but it is not necessary. See the point of the Buddha and then live it out. Yamada Roshi said to us Christians there, "I do not want to make you a Buddhist. I want to empty you in imitation of Christ your Lord," who emptied himself. I thought, well, this is ecumenism at its best. This Buddhist is going to make a Christian of me, finally. We must not expect too much of our teacher. Yamada Roshi made it clear. He said, I am teaching koans. I am trying to deepen your vision, and then you take your vision where you want to take it. I'm not a spiritual father. I'm not a guru. I'm not here to solve ultimate religious problems for you. I'm here to sharpen your vision. Like an optometrist, you know, he works on your glasses. Do you see it yet? Not yet. Okay, try this. Do you see it now? Finally, I think we must not sentimentalize Kensho. Kensho is an insight into the nature. Kensho means to see the nature, which means to see your own nature, to see the nature of the object in front of you, to see that you are really one here. It's the experience of unity, the experience of emptiness. It does not make a teacher infallible. It does not make a teacher impeccable. It does not free a teacher from addictions that he may have. It does not keep a teacher from making bad mistakes. So when Zen people say there is no difference between good and evil, they're talking in the absolute sense, in the practical, relative, ethical decisions that can be made. There's a big difference between good and evil. Therefore, as students, we must be docile. That means teachable. But we must be discreet and not give ourselves over, you know, to another. It's interesting that many Americans who are quite anti-clerical and dealing with their own clergy are absolutely prostrate before a Zen teacher, you know, and say, perhaps we could rethink this. I would say, too, about teachers, find a teacher you love. Find a teacher who loves you. When I was returned to the United States and was teaching at St. Peter's College, between classes, I had a telephone call from Yamada Roshi. He was in New York on business. He wanted to know if possibly I could find time to have lunch with him. Oh, yes, Yamada Roshi. I can find time to have lunch with you. Yamada Roshi, the branches stir the breeze to bid you farewell. I returned to the States. I was teaching at St. Peter's College, and I continued sitting as best I could. I finally began to find some peace. I had no more questions about Zen. I had no more hope either, really. I thought, I'll do the best I can, you know. It was my way. I will sit quietly and live out my life. At this time, I met Glassman Sensei. I met him in Los Angeles when I was sitting with Mayazumi Roshi, and then he came to New York to open up shop, and I asked if I could become his student. And different though we are in many ways, we hit it off. And he asked me to begin koan study. Now, I did not want to do this because Yamada Roshi's method of teaching was to stay on mu until you passed it, the first koan. And Glassman Sensei told me that that's one way of teaching, but you can kill people that way too. If they can't pass mu, they might finally give up and despair. He said that the koans are many different doors into the same room. Let's knock on all the doors until we see which one opens. Made a lot of sense finally, and so I did it. I saw him every week. We did a koan a week, and every Thursday I would go to him. When I'd go in the door of the bakery there, the people who were working there would say to me, well, Thursday afternoon, Father. I said, Thursday afternoon, and upstairs I'd go. And I began to feel for the first time my ship was leaving the dock. And then finally, for me, there was one koan that was definitive. I have some better understanding of the phrase of Jesus that we must die to ourself. It always seems so cruel, and now it seems like the greatest mercy. Zen has given me an insight into a wider self, which should not be surprising. St. Paul said, the mind has not conceived the things that God has prepared for those who love him. Life is an endless journey to see what the true self is, that it is not separate from the self of Christ, but there is only one Christ loving himself. And this will be an endless journey. It's never to be exhausted. I realize, too, in a sense, the unity with Christ, that there is no gap between myself and Christ. Ruben Habito mentioned this, but that we are not separate from Christ. We are Christ in this world. In the end, what have I learned? Well, the Zen poet said, a water bird comes and goes, leaving no traces at all. Yet it knows how to go its own way. Thank you.
I think I began my quest as a very small child. As far back as I can remember, I had a conviction that the everyday world is not the real world. And I was always trying to break through the surface or, you know, pull back a curtain. Catholicism seemed to offer hope. But the more I got to know other Catholics, the more they seemed to be concerned not with finding reality slash God, but with keeping rules. So at 11, I became an atheist. Neither my parents nor the aunt or uncle with whom I spent several summers attended church. So it was no problem for me to simply drop all religious observances. I think they may even have been a bit relieved. However, not long before my 13th birthday, I began to, the only word I can use is no. You know, and that doesn't mean cognitionally, but it's the word that fits. I began to know fleetingly a loving presence that asked me to assent to or deny it. I sensed that the assent would have to be expressed in a living relationship and began to search for a story that seemed to fit with my experience. What I found was a very different sort of Catholicism, rooted in the life and example of Jesus and teaching that God is self-emptying love. But the practices which fostered this relationship had developed within the religious orders, so I concluded that it was necessary to enter the religious state. Further, my gift of self would have to be as total as I could make it, and to me this meant entering the strictest religious order of which I knew, which was the Trappistines. I corresponded with the abbess, this was at Wrentham, which was the only, it was a very recent foundation and the only Trappistine foundation in the United States at that time. But because of parental opposition, I could not enter until I had come of age and had earned enough to cover the expenses involved, not only clothing, but the dowry. So I went to college, intending to become temporarily a teacher. In college, I met philosophy and Thomas Aquinas, who showed me that intelligent reflection could foster an even deeper commitment to God. I hungered to know more. What to do? Go to graduate school or go to work? I wrote the abbess asking for guidance and received the reply that she did not feel that I was called to her order. I was a little sad at this, and in another way, I was very much relieved. Oh boy, now I can go to graduate school. So I did go to graduate school. I spent two very happy years at Marquette in Milwaukee, and I got a teaching job at Fordham literally while the ink was drying on my MA. I got the degree in August and started teaching in September. 4 months later, I was engaged to another philosopher. We married a year later, and 2 months after our first anniversary, our son was born. A daughter followed 2 years later. All the while, I continued to teach full time and to work towards my PhD. There was neither time nor energy for more than Sunday Mass. But I felt that I had lost touch with what was most important, and I prayed for guidance. Again, I experienced a loving presence, much stronger and no longer fleeting. I longed to respond without reservation, but didn't know how. Neither could I find anyone who could give me wise guidance. I found plenty of people who were willing to give guidance, but none of it seemed to me very wise. That may have been just my own pride, but I kept pulling back. Therefore, when after several years God seemed to have vanished utterly, I took it very hard, blaming myself for failing to respond. Determined to serve God nevertheless, I tried everything within reach to remove whatever was blocking or holding me back. I spent some time in Jungian analysis and a longer time in the charismatic renewal. From both of them, I gained something, but neither of them dealt with the struggle that I was having. I had first learned of Zen from Father Kennedy in the fall of 1966. At that time, I read Inomi LaSalle's Zen Catholicism and tried to do Zazen, but it was too hard without a teacher, and I soon gave it up. Meanwhile, Bob had gone to Japan, studied Zen there, and continued with it after his return. When in 1980, some other students of his teacher established a Zendo, literally two blocks from my home, I felt as if I was being given a good, strong push, and it seemed only reasonable to give it another try. I thought of Zazen more or less as an ascetical practice whose goal was to break free of self-centeredness. And since it had to be my self-centeredness that had separated me from God, this practice seemed to offer some help. But I also felt some resentment that I could find no help in the Christian spiritual tradition. And I discovered a loyalty to Jesus that was not based on either argumentation nor a creedal commitment. It was simply there. So I was always trying to reconcile my practice and my loyalty. I couldn't leave Jesus, and neither could I entirely leave Zen, although I tried a good number of times. Even though it was less a matter of having chosen Zen practice than of simply not knowing what else to do. I learned early on that the reconciliation would have to be on an experiential level. The theoretical approach would get me nowhere. But all the time I kept asking, why must I do this? Why can't I find a more traditionally Christian practice that won't raise all these questions? And that has been a very long struggle. Only in the last 8 months has the internal conflict begun to subside. The inner rebellion has gone, and Zazen, while still an ascetical practice, has come to be prayer as well. In it, I'm expressing my longing to let go of self-centeredness so as to be open to God, to other persons, and to the whole world of other beings, responding to each in Jesus' spirit. There is no way that I can cause this transformation, but I believe that this is our true being and that I can be brought to it by God. So I practice in love, in trust, and in hope. Regarding such questions as to questions that have been raised here, as to whether God is personal or impersonal, a holy other out there or holy imminent, I have no answers, because I have no experience on which to base an answer, except that the presence never seemed to be either way out there. My Sufi friends have a beautiful expression. They say, Allah is closer to each of us than our jugular veins. Neither did this presence seem to be a thing. And I find the Christian belief in the Trinity, in whom there is distinction but no separation, both acceptable and reassuring.
The question of the relationship between Zen awakening and Christian contemplation is a way for me to focus on some of the deep issues that come when you try to practice in both traditions. Now, the problem is that it's very, very difficult to talk about. And if I were to say that these two experiences are different, I would feel very uncomfortable, because it would seem to be saying that there are two different kinds of absolutes, absolute reality, one for Buddhists and one for Christians. And I couldn't ever say that. If I were to say that these two ways are the same, then I would have to contend with people who I respect who would not agree with that. For example, D.T. Suzuki or Thomas Merton, both of whom have made statements in that way, that they would not just simply say they are the same. So the struggle is really to find a way to try to talk about this kind of deep question without flying off into something theoretical and abstract that gets away from experience. And on the other hand, trying to deal with it. If I give you a little idea of my own journey, perhaps you can see where I am coming from when I try to talk about that question. I grew up in a Catholic family, but I had never gone to any Catholic school, and frankly, I had no real personal contact with my faith. My family went to church, so I went to church, and as if I was asleep, and it wasn't just in regard to my faith, but it was also in regard to other whole parts of my life. I was sort of like a sleepwalker, and I had some obscure sense of wanting to find some meaning to my life, even though I couldn't quite articulate it that way. I had no philosophical or theological background at all, and I thought I would become a theoretical physicist, and that would be a way I could discover some kind of meaning. And then one summer, all that changed. I fell in love. Now that's a normal and natural thing to do when you meet an attractive girl and but somehow it wouldn't just stay like that, and it was as if I was compelled to ask, why was this girl so lovable? And it was almost as if it was like a spontaneous koan that I couldn't escape. It sort of grabbed hold of me, and I sort of, it consumed me sort of day after day, that I had to keep on asking this question, why is this girl so lovable? Because it was as if for the first time I began to awake, and she was the most real thing I had ever experienced. And I was attracted tremendously to her, and yet I had to question why that was so. Well, first I said, well, maybe it's because she's such a nice person, and it's because of her personality, of what she says and what she does. And while she was very nice, I saw as I really looked at her that was not the reason. That however nice she was, that wasn't the root of why she was so lovable. So I went back to pondering that again. Then I thought, well, maybe it's because somehow deep inside her, in her heart or in her soul or however I could try to express that, that's why she's so lovable, because there's some wonderful qualities there. So I looked at that, and I saw that it was as if she was the most real thing that had happened, and yet she was a reflection of something else, as if the source that was attracting me was not in her, but was somewhere else. At this point, I really was in deep trouble, because I didn't intend to do anything like this. I was very happy to be in love with this girl, and now I was led into some area that I had no knowledge or experience of. And it sounded like religion, but it didn't sound like anything I knew from going there in the large parish and, you know, going to church. And it was sort of like, I really didn't know what to do about it. And it was as if a door had opened onto two very closely united paths. And one was that the more I saw how real she was and how she was a person for me, the more I felt I could see, not certainly literally, but I could somehow see that that the source of this love I felt, or this light or warmth of, or whatever way I could express, was somewhere else. And then that was almost easy to see compared to what happened next, which was the feeling that this was an insight. This first path was an insight in sort of into the nature of things. And it very much kind of activated my mind at its deepest roots to see that. But then I saw that if this girl, this person, was so loving and so attractive, then the source of this love must somehow, in some way that I could not articulate, be somehow, I couldn't say personal, I would say personal if only it could be cleansed from all the limitations that were so clear to me. But somehow this mysterious presence was there, but I had no experience. It was as if a finger was pointing at it. And the next part of that journey was to say, what does this have to do with the kind of religious upbringing I had? Is it possible to actually enter into this darkness that is beyond all these human limits and try to find that presence, to find that loving presence that I know exists and yet I have no experience of? And it was in that way that I began to grasp the notion of faith. Now, faith, unfortunately, is usually understood as some kind of blind thing, but in reality, it's kind of it's a movement of the heart that reaches out to try to go out and explore this reality. It was after all this happened that I discovered Zen. And I discovered in a practical way by reading Philip Kaplow's Three Pillars and the stories of Yatsutani Roshi and his students, who was Yamada's teacher. And I was very struck by that because I said, wow. But I couldn't, it was like my own path, I had to look at it from where I had been. And so I had to ask myself, now how does this relate to what Thomas Aquinas was contemplating when he looked at the mystery of existence, or what John of the Cross was singing about when he was in his little prison cell in Toledo, being tormented by his brothers in religion and had these deep experiences of God. And so that became the context in which I would sit. Now, there's certainly no time to go into how you might articulate from a Christian point of view what Zen is. I just want to give you some idea of the direction that I've been traveling, and that is that I very much believe that both Christian mysticism and Zen are experiencing the same reality. I can't get away from that. It's the same mysterious reality. At the same time, I feel that just as Christian metaphysical experiences that reality in one way, and Christian mysticism experiences in another, then Zen too has its very distinctive way of experiencing that reality.
I was raised as a Catholic, but when I was a teenager, I had a very bad time of it because Catholicism, the beliefs that I had as a child no longer worked. I was reading books about how life has no meaning, death will just be blackness, And so I didn't know what to do about that. And I remember looking at a little baby and thinking, what is this child? What's going to happen to this child? What's the future? What's the eternity of this child? Or I'd look at the stars and I'd say, how wide, how great, how expansive is our universe? So I literally went through agony because I did not want to live without God. I felt that if I couldn't have God, then life wasn't worth anything. So after a year and a half, I went into my room and I demanded a miracle. But it didn't happen, at least not the way I thought it would happen. So I decided that if I couldn't live without God, then I would choose to live with him. And it's as if a hand went into the very core of myself, turned me around, and focused everything so that the agony I'd felt, the torture of a year and a half, went away, and I felt peaceful for the first time in my adult life. After that, I decided to do a lot of reading, and what really called to me was reading about the mystics. I found myself reading St. Teresa and St. John, and I wanted to experience mystical union. So what had happened as a teenager was something permanent had happened. That shift in that few seconds remained permanent in me. Later when I got together and we started reading Zen, we got excited about that. One time we decided to take a few months off and take a retreat. We had two children, they were 3 and 4 at the time, and we went to the cliffs at San Onofre in California. We were in a state park there. And we would alternate days. One person would sit all day, and the other one would take care of the kids and cook the meals. After 6 weeks, it was like I would stare at a blade of grass, or I would notice the end of a tip of a branch. I did not become a mystic after reading St. John. I did not experience infused contemplation. As a Zen student, I did not experience awakenings, but I would have little flashes of the beauty of a flower would leap out at me, or the inner sense of a person would talk to me, or the sunshine hitting a coffee cup would just, I just couldn't talk about it. It was just a beautiful thing. But these are just little touches. So the way we stand now is that when we sit, or when I sit, I find myself trying to breathe, trying to quiet the mind, trying to reach a special Zen kind of stillness. I rest in that for a while, and then I find my heart beginning to open up and reach toward God as in that desire for union. So my heart becomes active, and I know that I'm in a state of prayer. Then after a while, I'll go back into the Zen sitting, and it's like alternating. It's like two parts of the one cloth. So that's where we stand now. That's how we feel, that Zen and Christianity are not fighting one another. They are together. If I were to choose to simply pray, it wouldn't be enough for me. I would need to sit. If I chose simply to sit, I feel that would not be enough either, because then my heart would be missing something.
I'm Robert Maiola from National Taiwan University. And as several people have testified, and as we've, the question just before us now is whether, in fact, this pull that we have, or this tear sometimes we have in ourselves because of what seems to be a contradiction between Christianity and Buddhism, has also confronted me. And what I have found very helpful, and for those who aren't right now getting better direction and promptings otherwise, what I would in that case recommend is that you make precisely this double bind, your koan, otherwise your koan. So we are actually in this room, I think, where the two bars of the cross or the X, the Buddhist X or the Christian cross intersect.
To go back and forth is a wonderful thing. And sometimes you don't really understand yourself until you've gone to something that is other and is very different from yourself. And that may be one of the marks of our spiritual pilgrimage in general is to take this traveling very seriously. And this traveling is something that involves an embracing of paradox and of inconsistency. And when you think of Ganjin's tradition, that's my tradition in Zen, the Soto tradition more. I mean, he openly talked about paradox, and obviously being confused, and any of us who have done koan study know that that's something you go through. But when you do go through that, you do meet something that's different from yourself. And it does seem to me that one of the exciting things about all of the journeys we've been hearing about today is this thing about moving to somewhere else.
I've been practicing for several years a very aniconic type of Christian meditation that has been called centering prayer. And it's interesting, I found that as my journey has gone on, my prayer focus has, the word has changed to finally the point it's my breath, okay? And what I find myself asking myself is, gee, I also do Buddhist sitting meditation, and sometimes I think there's a difference, sometimes I think there's not. Sometimes it seems like when my eyes are closed, I'm a Christian, when it's open, they're open, I'm a Buddhist. Okay. What has, let's say, led you into Zen practice as, let's say, opposed to doing some type of similar type of Christian practice, and how do you see the two related?
I don't think there really was anything at all like Zen in Christian practice that I learned. It just wasn't there. Nowadays, under the influence of Zen and of insight meditation, the Vipassana, and such Eastern practices, as far as I can see, there is some return to ancient Christian practice. But I think even that is modified already and is a modern version of some of those ancient disciplines which have taken in a lot of Zen, a lot of modern psychology, and have produced something like centering prayer. But I knew of nothing in my own Christian background that was anything like Zen, anything like it. And people used to talk about the nada, nada, nada of John of the Cross. I would try to read John of the Cross, and it was such a head trip, I was totally lost.
Do you find that Zen brought you back to this personal Christ? Do you find that the Buddha led you to meet Christ once again, or always? How do you reconcile this personal God in Christianity, Christ, and the Buddha, or the Zen awakening?
I think what Zen has helped me to do is to find myself, not so much even God or Christ, it helped put me in touch with myself. And it helped me to understand what I always read about my own tradition but never really grasped, that Christ is not other than I am. St. Augustine said there's only one Christ loving himself. And that I am not kneeling before Christ asking for, say, salvation, but I realize that in my own limited way, I am Christ, loving, working, saving in this world. There's no gap here. And that has been a revelation to me in the flesh.
Some of us were talking in the coffee break about the lack that seems to be emerging as far as the Christian contemplative tradition is concerned. I mean, everyone who's rediscovered contemplation, it seems to me, who's been talking here, has rediscovered it through encountering Zen. So what I'd like to ask, I don't know if there are any answers to this, is what happened to our Christian contemplative tradition? I mean, did we lose it?
I think we have to say honestly that since the Council of Trent, it was actively discouraged, at least in the Catholic Church, because they were afraid of uneducated people getting some sort of experience and going off the deep end, and there was the Brethren of the Free Spirit who were celebrating orgies and so on and so forth. And that was the attitude right up until the beginning of this century. And there are books that deal with this, that at the beginning of the century there began to be a change to get back to the earlier tradition.
And one of the things that has struck me as I have listened to this group, 7 out of 9 being Catholic in tradition. And I get the sense that here there's a dominance of Catholics and or ex-Catholics. What is it that has drawn Catholics? Is it the strong liturgical tradition? Is it the ecclesiastical structure? What is it that has seemed to drive Catholics more in the contemplative direction than perhaps mainline Protestants? I think maybe that was even true of the charismatic movement.
It's the question I have had again and again as I delve into Buddhism, Zen, the Vajrayana, the Tibetan tradition, other traditions. Where does it come together? And I don't ask that on a metaphysical level. I don't ask that out of philosophical curiosity. I ask that as just a Christian trying to understand the treasures of Buddhism. How does it relate? Is it relatable? And I think that somehow it must be. Up the road of history, when we've worked out the language of understanding one another's experience, we'll see how it relates. And I, for one, do not believe it is possible that the Christian mystical experience is less than Zen or less than Tibetan mysticism or vice versa. It's not that at all. It's not instead of, it's in addition to. But I really would like to know how they relate as a matter of integration, not as simple curiosity.
You know, I learned about Christianity from a Sapatera in a monastery in the forest in Thailand. And I thought, why is it that there's no Christian teaching that really teaches you to contemplate in a meaningful sort of way? And as I listened to the talk, I mean, it amazed me to see all the testimony being presented, in a sense. And I thought, well, where's the Christian contemplation side of this? So I guess my question is, what are you going to teach? As many of you are teaching, what do you teach the families and the children that come in terms of this integration?
The concept of contemplation within the Christian tradition, one, has not been lost in the Eastern Orthodox tradition, is still alive and well, has never died. Two, I hear that there's a real problem with the rational thought, and the Tibet tradition does not throw out the rational process by any stretch of the imagination. So I would suggest that perhaps before we throw out the baby with the bathwater, perhaps there is a different way to integrate rational thought, logical thought with one's practice. Finally, over the past 20 years, I've been teaching comparative spiritual disciplines. Now, my job is not to make Christians into Buddhists. My job is to make Christians better Christians, Buddhists better Buddhists, Jews better Jews, members of the Nation of Islam better Muslims, perhaps. But what has occurred to me is not to try to teach Christians Buddhist practice. In fact, my job is to look at them and say, look at what I call your birthright. What tradition, if you were born into a tradition, before you go off and throw out this stuff because you've hit a stone in the road or a boulder in the road, because the stones and boulders in the road are very important to grapple with. So before you go off and be something weird like a Buddhist or Hindu, maybe you ought to really look seriously at your tradition, because after 20 years I'm convinced it's not just the Orthodox tradition that has a long contemplative tradition, and not just the Roman Catholic tradition, but if you're willing to dig and spend some time digging, there is the tradition well within Calvinism, well within Lutheranism. So that I think that this dialogue is interesting, But I also worry sometimes that when we reconstruct a Christian theology based on a Buddhist overlay or Buddhist integration, that we might miss something in the process. Let's not have an Eastern Asian interpretation, reinterpretation of Christianity, or a scientific new physics interpretation of Christianity. But maybe what they really need to work hard is to really move ahead and think very seriously about a new Christian interpretation of Christianity.
Among Christians, there were almost two schools of thought. In one, the two traditions were seen as distinct yet vitally interacting. In the other, they were seen as the same thing but using different terminology. Now, to me, that is a very critical question, and I believe our own panel and perhaps even the audience, we embody that whole spectrum of positions. Now, certainly, we're all working towards that, but I would sort of like to get a sense if how people feel about that issue. Because if we take Christianity, and I'm talking about Christians more than Buddhists, because Buddhists are going to look at Christianity with Buddhist eyes because that's the way they have to start there. But I'm talking about two ways Christians can look at Zen coming into the church. And in one of them, I have the sort of trepidation that Christianity is sort of begins to be interpreted in Buddhist categories. And I'm not particularly comfortable with that. Another way I see that the integrity of the Christian tradition can be maintained and enter into a genuine dialogue with Zen. But I do see those two different things.
Evolution is in every level all the time going on. And I would say for me, from my experience, the most helpful thing that evolution goes on is to encounter the opposite. Means not to be identified with the opposite, but to encounter the opposite, the other pole, from heart to heart. And this really means to go into the heart of this opposite, whatever it is, to know it, to go into this egg and shell. This must be the first step. But then, through this encounter, which has nothing to do with identification, really nothing. Through this encounter, we became transformed. We became different, both sides. If we not became transformed, there is no real encounter. And nothing new will evolve. So for me, evolution means always encounter the opposite. Let us transform, being transformed, and then look what comes out new. And I think I would never have wanted to become a Zen teacher if Yamada Roshi would not have been the teacher he was, the master he was. And he always said to us, Zen is born within Buddhism, but it can be transferred to other religions. That's exactly the greatness of Zen.